Welcome to Archery Talk 101 podcast, your guide to better archery skills. We'll bring you the latest tips, tricks, and expert advice, but that's not all. We'll also have interviews with top archers and industry professionals and reviews of the latest gear and equipment and much more. Hi, my name is Rory Canterbury. I'm your host on Archery Talk 101, and we have a special guest with us today, Nick. He's going to join us on the show and talk about all the exciting archery things he's been doing, and in his background, it looks like he has a nice little elk in the back that I'd like to hear about that hunt. Welcome to the show, yeah. Nick.
Hi. The elk in the background actually isn't one that I shot. That one was from a friend who passed away, who was a taxidermist. And so we needed a place to put it. So here it is.
Well, it's nice that you'll be able to preserve it and you know where it come from and everything else.
Yep.
So introduce yourself to our audience and let us know a little something about you.
Okay. I'm Nick Holloway. I've got a little archery shop in Emmett, Idaho. I've been doing archery. I think I talked my dad into letting me buy a little bear Indian bow when I was about 6 years old. So I've been doing it ever since. I was pretty fortunate to have an uncle who was really good at archery and understood it really well. And so I learned quickly at a young age how to set my stuff up and do my own thing kind of. So I've never even really been to an archery shop besides mine. I've never had anyone work on my stuff except for my uncle and me. So it's kind of a funny situation when I look at everybody else, you know. That's how I got started. You know, my dad wasn't a big hunter. He went hunting once in a while and he had a bow and he would shoot it, you know, at his buddy's house or something, I guess. And so my uncle, who was really into archery, I was a little kid with a million questions. I'd follow him around and drive him completely crazy. And he would let me from the time I was about 13, until I was 18, I went to his hunting camp, which was a big family camp. And we would have, I mean, the sign said anywhere from 1 to 60 people at any given time that we hung on the tree, you know. And we would tune bows all day long and shoot bows. And, you know, in the morning and the evening, we would go out and hunt for deer and elk every day. So it was a pretty fun experience. I got to stay there even without my family being involved. I would just stay in a little tent or maybe with my uncle in the camper and he would pick me up on his way to and from his hunting camp. my mom would let me go. So I would stay there for a week in his tent and ride his four wheeler around and try to get a deer. You know, it was pretty funny actually, but a good time for sure.
So. Yeah. So is your shop just basically for you or do you work on other people's equipment or?
We do. We work on all kinds of stuff, whatever comes in. We do a little bit of crossbow stuff. You know, we sell bow tech and diamond bows mostly right now, just because we're small in a small town. A little website going. So hopefully someday that takes off a little bit. But
well, what's the name of your shop?
It's Low Mountain Archery.
Low Mountain Archery. Okay. Yeah. If they wanted to get a hold of you, how would they get a hold of you?
Probably getting on Facebook is probably the easiest way. I also have a construction business, so I'm always up in the mountains building, working on houses and stuff. And so I'm in and out a lot. We're only open in the evenings and Saturdays. So
the name of your website is what, lowmountainarchery.com then?
Yes.
Okay. Now I know those listening on the podcast won't be able to see this, but we're going to let you see your website once I get it up here where we can look at it. You like the right buttons. There we go. There's your website. A lot of good information out here. I'm assuming you got bows.
Yeah, we're working on all of it all the time. It's, you know, something we're doing on our own at, after work. So it's a slow process, but
yeah. So you got some fishing and hunting stuff and a whole bunch of other stuff. So yeah, so if you're interested, if you're in that area, definitely look you up, right?
Yeah, for sure. For sure. We also build, I have a friend that is kind of partnered with me, but he builds custom fishing rods also here in our shop. So we're a little tiny shop trying to grow, you know, one thing at a time. So
yeah, you got a phone number here for you, 208-371-9524.
Yes.
You're at 1010 and a half South Washington, Emmett, Idaho.
Yep.
So yeah, you're up in the area. Definitely, if I get up to Idaho, I'll definitely stop in and see you.
Yeah, that would be fun.
Yeah. You know, having a shop myself, it's fun working on equipment and having, basically sometimes weird problems come in and you look at it and it's like, oh, this only not only weird to you, this looks right. Simple to me.
Yeah.
And then you fix it, hand it back to them, and it's like, oh, you're a genius.
Yeah. And then sometimes you scratch your head for a couple of days trying to figure it out.
Yeah. But and I've had some come in, you know, when I have my shop, and it's like, okay, you can't watch what I'm doing. I'm working on when you're not here, because stuff I'm doing to your bow, you're not going to like me doing it when I take a drill and drill bit and I'm drilling on your cans because you got a stripped out bolt.
Yep.
You know, yep. I have to drill through just right to get the head off so I can get the bolt out and put a new one in. And
Yeah, you're always back there with a torch and a drill and all kinds of stuff fixing things. So, yeah.
Yeah. And I know one place I was working. I think when I worked had my own shop for a while, and then I worked at Bass Pro and worked at Cabela's in the archery department. And I remember this one boat came in. I don't know why it was, but PSC had changed threaded where the sight bolts on was the wrong thread. And I knew what the thread was, so I could figure that out. But finding a tap, there's no place around I could just go quickly go buy a tap. So I ended up having to order from China, because it was like a third the price of a tap, you know, that I could find order in here made who knows where. And Interesting, when I got the tap in, see, I bought it myself. I took it in. I used the tap. And of course, I brought it back home because, you know, it was my tap. And I had it anymore and retapped those threads, bolted a sight on it, and we sold the bow.
Yeah.
It was like the day I fixed it, it got sold.
Yeah.
You know, until then, otherwise, you know, what do you have? Find it right, the different screws, and then it didn't match anybody's bows.
Yeah. It's kind of a pain trying to figure that stuff out sometimes. Yeah.
Yeah. And I was like, why is this not fastening in there? So I went and checked. Yep. Sure enough, wrong thread.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm always getting something somebody's glued together with epoxy, and then, you know, you got to get it apart. And then you got to figure out how you're going to put that back together when you're all done. Oh, it's a mess sometimes.
Yeah. Sometimes if you don't know what you're doing, you're better off to take it in, let somebody fix it. And it's just one of those things that, you know, that's how we learned, was messing it up and fixing it.
Right. You know? I just had, I was out of town for a day, and the kid that works for me, Dylan, he was in here and he called me. He's like, I got a problem with this bow. And I think it was a Bowtech carbon bow. Anyways, the let off was wrong, and we were talking through it, and finally we figured out, it was an Assassin is what it was, Bowtech Assassin. Oh. And so we're talking through it quite a bit. I'm like, man, I'd be looking at the mods and try to figure that out and your draw stops and stuff, you know. And it took him a while, but there was a 4-on-1 mod, and there was an H on the other. But he thought they were both fours.
So anyways,
he finally figured that out. But it's just kind of fun, you know, learning, and you just sit down and look at it for a minute and think about it. Usually you can figure it out. So
well, and then next time he'll know the look for that, you know,
right,
he'll be aware of that. So one time problem, you fixed it, and that don't work. So
yes, super simple, but it's a big problem until you fix it.
I know, and I had my store last time, you know. Kids had come in with bows that they couldn't draw back, so they cranked the limbs out. And I remember this one kid come in with his dad. The limbs were out of the pocket and, you know, slightly turned because they was above the pocket. And on those, the bows, they had to have at least half of the limb inside the pocket. Mm-hmm. You know, any more, any less than that, and it could easily twist out of it, break the pocket, and then your bow comes apart. And the interesting part was he went to the other shop, one of the other shops in town, and they fixed it because he did the same thing, cranked it out too far. And she told him, it's like, okay, you cannot crank it out any further. This is as far as you can go. So they come into me, and I says, okay, well, it's $20. At that time, it was $20 to press a bow, no matter what I did to it.
Right.
I did use my press for putting in peeps, but I didn't charge that because it was just to hold it for me, you know?
Right.
And so I told him it's $20 to put it in. And so I told the guy, you might want to stand back because this could come apart. Because there's nothing keeping the limbs from twisting. You know, only the pressure of the old, you know, Apple bow presses, you know, push, you know, hold outside the limbs, you push on the riser and, you know, they kind of bend in so it could easily turn. Yep. But, you know, the rollers kind of help it from doing that. But so I told him, stand back. And so I pressed it, put him back in place. And I told him, okay, this is as far out as you can turn it. And then I, you know, that's when I found out he went to the other place. Dad said, went there and said, okay, this is $20 this time. Next time you do that, it's $40 because it's a $20 stupid fee. His dad laughed.
it's amazing how far people will take things the wrong direction sometimes. You just wow, that's like, it's like looking at a mouse trap, you know what I mean? You touch that thing and it's gonna bite you.
Well, and then your bows had about a 10-pound range, four full turns. Right. And I know on the PSEs, I could actually turn them six and still be safe.
Mm-hmm.
So if I had to, I would go out six, you know, because it was still safe at that range, but they only recommended four. But, you know, lots of times what I do is if they couldn't pull it back, I just, you know, put a shorter string on it and, you know, that'd shorten it up and, you know, fix it. I fixed a lot of draw links by changing string lengths and cable links and
twisting things up.
Yeah, sometimes you have to do more than twisting, you know, when you need 10 pounds, you got to do the strings and cables because there's just no way to get there otherwise.
Right. Yep.
So you told us kind of how you got started in archery. What have you been doing since you were that little kid and in between now and now having your own shop?
Well, I'm a big hunter. I love hunting. I mean, as my mom says, as soon as I could walk, I had a stick. And if there was any water in any mud puddle or anywhere, I was fishing or something, you know, which is funny because I wasn't following my dad around doing that so much, but that's just how I was when I was born. So, you know, growing up as a kid, I was pretty fortunate in a couple ways. One of my friends, who is my best friend, his dad was really into building guns. So, I mean, I was at his house one day and we were tearing apart some Mauser or something and grinding thing. I mean, we were making gun parts all the time, just building all kinds of stuff. I was always involved in that. And then I would archery hunt every year and everybody would have a hard time understanding why I would archery hunt when I had guns and I was always shooting them. And I was like, you can't explain what it's like to hunt with a bow. If you hunt with a bow very much, you go gun hunting, rifle hunting. I still do that, but it's not the same. You don't get the same experience. So, you know, I spent all my time hunting and fishing, everything I can do. If I'm not working, I've been in construction my whole life. I'm out somewhere hunting and fishing. You know what I mean? I think when I was 17, I shot my first 4-point mule deer. And I think it was, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 bucks in a row. And five of them are 4 points with a bow consecutive years after that. So there are no monsters, you know, but some decent sized 4 points. So I don't know. I live to go out hunting. I like shooting competition. I like competing, but I'm more of a hunter, if that makes sense. So.
Yeah, that kind of makes sense. I like shooting targets and spots because it develops my skill to know I can, if I aim correctly, I can hit it. And then I always like going to the 3D shoots because that helps you judge yardage and not exactly pick your spot because shooting a 3D target is not the same spot you're going to shoot on a live animal, because you got different angles and stuff, so you might have to do a different spot. But at least I know if I pick the spot, which I've gone out there and shot at a deer and forgot to pick the spot and completely missed it at, you know, at 10 yards. So right. I forgot to pick a spot. I just looked at the deer and pointed in that general direction and went. But, you know, things like that happen. All that is just to get ready to go hunt.
So my dad, I mean, periodically he decides he's going to go hunting. And one year I had been out hunting and I think I already had my deer and stuff shot. So he says, well, let's go hunting. I want to go shoot something. And he gets his bow out and I help him kind of set it up, you know, for an hour. And then he's like, all right, let's go. And I'm just like, oh boy. Well, we drive up the mountain and you talk about picking a spot. We were going around this mountain and there was a tree there and there's a big mule deer doe laying under that. For him, that was all he wanted. You know what I mean? He didn't care at all whether it had horns or not. He just wanted to try and shoot one with a bow. So I range it and I'm like, okay, it's 35 yards. He's like, okay, 35. I said 35. And he shoots. And it looked like the arrow went right in the deer's mouth and the deer rolled over backwards and ran out the back of the tree straight away. And I couldn't see where it really went. And I was like, I was just kind of shaking my head thinking about what I thought I had just seen, you know? And he's like, where'd I hit it? Where'd I hit it? And I was like, I don't know. It looked like it went right in its mouth to me, you know? And he's like, what? And I was like, what were you aiming at? He's like, I don't know. I was just looking at the ears. he totally forgot to aim. He didn't even think about it. I mean, sights, nothing happened. He just got lucky and it actually went through the deer's nose and it came out the back of the head. That deer still ran like, I don't know, 400 yards. So I don't know. It was just a funny experience, but you talk about picking a spot and the more you hunt with archery equipment, the more you learn how important that really is and how much effort it takes on your part to do that when an animal shows up, you know.
Even just, you know, I remember the first time I went to a 3D shoot, you know, shooting at the foam animal target was a little nerve-wracking. It's like, and then after you I was like, well, it's just foam.
but picking that spot and aiming for something specific is it's really important. So you got to have a spot.
So tell us about probably your most exciting hunt you've been on.
I don't know. I've had a lot of really fun hunts with a bow. I'll just tell you, last year I was busy with work and had a lot of things going on. So I wasn't able to get the time that I really like. I mean, I would like to have at least a week or maybe two to go elk hunting, you know, but work wasn't letting me do that. So I only had 3 days and I had a buddy, he said, let's go. We went out a couple of times, we were calling elk. And I mean, I bugled so much that I almost couldn't talk. My throat was so sore for 2 days, you know, and we were just in bowls and it just, no matter what we did, it wouldn't work out. We were crawling around in the brush with them. Every time we got there, the wind would shift just a little bit and they would just move just out of range. And so we spent 2 days bugling and talking to bulls from, you know, daylight till dark practically. And we just couldn't, either one of us could get a shot. No matter what we did, we'd taken turns going in after the bull and calling for each other. Anyways, it didn't work out. So 2 days later, I called a buddy who he had got a bow because I said, hey, let's go. He was kind of losing his love for hunting because he was shooting everything with a gun. And he was like, yeah, you know, it's just not exciting to me anymore. I just don't really like it. And I was like, you should get a bow. It'll change everything for you.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah. And so, so he gets a bow and he starts shooting and he's pretty good at it. He bought my last year's bow. And then I got the new one that they came out with. and we got him all dialed in, and we went to Wyoming and went antelope hunting. So we shot our antelope and we came back that year, and he said, I want to try this next year. Well, I didn't have the time to help him with elk, so he hadn't gone out, but I called him the last day. I said, hey, so last day, I was like, or second to last day, I was like, I only have today to hunt, but let's go see, because they're bugling in one spot pretty good. So we get up there. The first thing we did is I parked my little pickup in the bottom of this draw, and I bugle, and they bugled, of course, 200 yards from the truck. They just started screaming, you know, and he's like, oh my gosh, look at that. You're listening to that. And it's not even daylight yet. Well, we take off. I was like, well, we need to hurry and get up there and try to get on them before they move off up the mountain. And we got pretty close into them. And we had a guy come in, you know, the guy came from behind us, and we saw him coming, and I kind of nodded, hey, and he nodded back, hey, and I turned around and bugled again, and I turned around and look, and the guy's walking past me at 20 yards, and he walked right in front of me and sat down to shoot the elk I was calling in. I was kind of like, holy cow, you know, like, this guy's brave. Anyways, we ended up, I said, well, take that guy, you guys split up on this little ridge. And I called in a couple of bulls to him, and the guy he's shot some really nice bulls, and he's been there when bulls that are in that 350, 360 range have been shot. So he knows what they look like. So I would take his word pretty well for what he's looking at, you know? And he said he had a pretty good 6-point, which I'm thinking was around a 300 inch bull, come right down to 23 yards. It was just on the other side of the tree from him. And he's just talking about the buck fever and, you know, being so excited, he couldn't even keep an arrow on his bow. And he's thinking, I'm going to get this elk, you know, but he doesn't know what to do. He doesn't know when to move, because he's never had the experience. Well, yeah. Then he looks off up the hill, and 60 yards away, there's this other bull coming down. And he said it's the biggest one he's ever seen. So I don't know if that's a 360 or a 380, you know, I don't know how big, I never did see it. Anyways, just seeing him so excited that he couldn't even hardly hold on to his bow after kind of giving up on having fun hunting.
Yeah,
that was pretty cool. And then we that whole thing fell apart with the guy that was there. Ended up coming in between him and the elk and shot a calf elk while we were calling, you know, which is fine. I'm glad he got his elk, but we helped him find that. We moved up the ridge a ways and to a spot where I'd called the bull a couple days before. And sure enough, he was there again. He bugled back pretty quick. So I said, grab your stuff, let's run down the mountain. We went down there a little ways, and I'm bugling at this bull, and he's only about 25 yards from me. And my buddy's on the other side of the bush. And I mean, I have a big chaparral bush in front of me, between me and the elk, and there's a tree, and he's just killing the tree on the other side, right? There's branches flying around. I mean, he's going crazy. I'm throwing logs, stomping, ripping grass out of the ground, making every noise I can think of that sounds like an elk to get him to step out. But he was close enough that he just wouldn't do it. He was like, nope, I'm waiting until I see you. And then, you know, every elk hunter's nightmare, when you're bugling a bull, you feel the wind hit the back of your neck. And I was just like, what do I do now? You know, because I got this big bush in front of me and I can't go around it quick enough. So I just climbed literally right through this bush, right in front of my guy that was trying to get a shot. And I went right to the tree where the elk was at. So when I stepped out, he was there, and I was ready enough that he didn't really get a chance to see what I was. And I got him, you know, he was a nice 5-point bull. But it just the excitement of being, I mean, I was having fun with the elk, and then I would look over at him and he's trying to pull his bow back and his hands are just shaking. And he didn't know what to do. And he was so excited that to this day, he's like, I just think about it and I get goosebumps on my arms, you know, and we're going to go a couple days again this year. But I don't know. It's pretty exciting. Every year is like that, whether I get one or I don't. I have a really good time doing it, because I always end up with some pretty close encounters like that. So whether it's my kids just, you know, getting excited and not being able to get a shot off or shooting and missing or whatever it is, it's hard to explain to somebody the difference in that and hunting with a rifle, because I do both every year. But yeah, the bow hunting is just, it's so personal.
It is, you know, and I do both as well, you know, but, you know, archery is kind of my preferred way, but sometimes
right.
it just doesn't work out. And yep. Depending where you're at, you know, there's one area that we're in that they don't come out during the day.
Yeah.
So they come out right before sunrise and, you know, sometimes you just can't get them. You got to sit back a ways so they finally get to you when it's daylight and it's an open field. So you can't put anything out there. So, you know, that one spot's pretty much your rifle because we got to be able to wait for them to come out. When they come out a half hour before shooting time, yeah, what do you do? You know, you're going to miss them in archery because they're not going to be there.
Yep. Yeah, it's fun. I just bow hunting and watching people do it and have that experience is super fun for me. You know, I just enjoy it every minute of it. I've shot enough stuff now that I have just as much fun helping someone as I do shooting them myself. Not that I mean, I'm happy to shoot, but I'm also happy to watch somebody else shoot, you know what I mean?
Right.
So anyways, I have a lot of fun. If you hunt long, bow hunt long enough, you've got a lot of stories to tell.
Yeah. That is kind of an exciting story, you know, get the guy out there that's, you know, almost thought, you know, hunting was, you know, kind of not really much for him anymore. And then get out there and so nervous and so excited, couldn't even draw the bow back.
Right. It was just funny. Yeah. I mean, he was kind of like, he was trying to get the shot at this bull, but he should have been moving, but he's never done it before. So he just didn't know what he's like. That thing's only 25 yards. I don't want to move. It's going to see me. And I'm like, well, you got to move. If that's your opportunity, when he puts his head in that tree and starts ripping the tree apart, you move, you know? It was just so fun. I mean, he would be sitting there shaking, trying to draw his bow back. And I would turn around and bugle behind me and he would think a bull was coming from behind him. So it was just chaos, you know, just super, super exciting and super fun. And yeah, it was just a good experience. So, yeah.
Yeah. That sounds like that's kind of the fun part of elk is you bugle and they answer back, you know, where the deer you grunt, you don't really hear them grunting back at you as much. As you do like with an elk and
it's different. I was hunting with some friends earlier this year and they were from back east, and so they were really big into turkey hunting. We were hunting turkeys and we did pretty good on the turkey hunt, but they were like, well, do you hunt turkeys a lot? And I'm like, well, if I have time I hunt turkeys, but the reason you guys hunt turkeys so hard is because you don't have elk. if you had elk, turkey hunting is fun, but it's hard to compare the two to me anyways. Like I had a lot of fun hunting turkeys this year, but it's just funny because elk hunting is, it's just hard to explain once you've learned enough about it and you learn how to get in them and they start talking. Like it's second to none, I think.
Yeah. Well, and when you look at it too, you know, in the fall, you've got your elk, you've got your turkey, you've got your deer, everything's all at the same time. You know, it seems like, I don't know about up here, but you know, in Nebraska, our turkey season kind of overlaps part of our deer season. And you know, am I going to go for a turkey or a deer? Right. A whole lot more meat from a deer. And I'm still going to be sitting either way. You know, whether I'm sitting in a blind on the ground for a turkey or up in a tree stand for a deer, you're still going to sit, you're different calls is all.
It's a lot different. I mean, we had a really good time and, you know, they were from out of town. So in, I think it was in 2 days, there was four of them and we ended up with eight turkeys. So that was pretty good. We got the last one right at dark on the last day, just before he couldn't shoot him anymore. And he was so tired. He's like, I'm really excited. I know I'm not smiling like I should, but, but I'm just so tired. We hiked all over. And another thing is about hunting in Idaho, almost no matter what you hunt, there's a lot of mountains. So it's hard to prepare for that when you're not used to it.
Right.
Yeah. So it gets guys pretty wore out.
Yeah, especially if you're not used to doing all that walking in the mountains and.
Yeah. Yep. Yep. It's pretty good. I had some friends come from Kansas a few years ago, and they were like, "Well, we're hiking the mountain 4 or 5 times every day," and I was like, "Well, how big is your mountain?" They showed me what here we wouldn't even call it a hill. You know what I mean? It's just just part of our terrain, I guess. It's not even considered a foothill hardly. He's like, "I've been going running up that 4 times a day," and I was like, "Boy, you better put your pack on and do it a few more times, because it's just hard to explain like what some of the hunting can be like here. It's pretty rough." So, I mean, not all of it is, but there's a lot that's pretty hard. So,
yeah, we have bluffs here. You can't call them mountains. They're just bluffs. And,
yeah,
you know, some of it feels pretty steep, but not like in the mountains, you know. You know, I've been out in the mountains in Colorado, and it's pretty much, you know, 30 degree slope or better going up, or even steeper sometimes. And,
right,
you know, it's quite a bit of climbing. And
Yeah. Colorado's, it's got some big, high, steep mountains there for sure. So yeah, pretty stuff.
Yeah. I haven't been to Idaho too much. I've been back a couple of times. I was born in Idaho, and then when I was a kid, we went back, and then I went back one other time. And, of course, I couldn't get where I was born because I was born on an Air Force base. But, you know, as a veteran, I don't get on there. If I retired, I could get on the base. But yeah, vet don't want vets on. But really? You know, it's just as somebody that served, I don't have access to the base. Now, if I retired from the military, then I have access to the base.
Okay.
But, you know, I was born at Mountain Home Air Force Base.
Yeah,
and I don't.
That's not too far from here. I've worked on that a few times. So
Yeah.
It's only about an hour and a half from where I'm at. So
That's not too far.
Yeah. No, it's not. It's not too bad at all.
But, yeah. My parents lived in Glensferry, Idaho. They lived. Yeah. Which is not too far from the base, but
no, it's kind of a pretty little place too. It's kind of a neat spot. I do a lot of coyote hunting, and so I get around out there quite a bit and shoot a few coyotes out around that area. So
yeah, we have some we need to get rid of out here too. That, you know, the area I was telling you about that has the deer come through at night, there's a lot of coyotes. Uh-huh. And we see coyotes all the time and raccoons, and you know, the coyotes are going to kill a lot of deer.
Oh yeah.
You know, we need to get rid of those, and I need to get with the trapper that is right here and see what you can do, because, you know, in Nebraska as a veteran, I get my permit really cheap, and in otherwise it's gonna be 70, I think it's 62 or 65, something like that, I forget now, but it's you know, for $5 we get one. It's the hunt, the fish, the fur bearing permit, the all the stamps you need. It doesn't include like deer and turkey and antelope and all that kind of stuff, but it's your basic hunting, fishing permit, and fur bearers permit. So I can, I can go through and, you know, do some of that stuff. And hey, if I know a trapper, I was like, okay, here's where I want to put them, because we know where the den is.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't want to go try taking a bow, because a lot of times they come out at night. But, you know, if I see one during the day, but that area that's has all the deer in it, there's not a good tree to get up in.
Yeah.
So the trees are, you know, kind of not a good spot. So, you know, I'm going to have to figure that out a little bit too. And
I had a friend that I met him at Cabela's, and I was on my way to Canada to go on a whitetail deer hunt. Anyways, we started talking, and I was trying to learn how to take pictures and do a little bit of video. And he turns out he's an ambassador for the kind of camera that I was using. And he was just playing at Cabela's so he could meet people. But anyways, he's in there working, and we started talking, and, you know, a few months later, I invited him on a coyote hunt, and we went out. We've been really good friends ever since, but he was kind of a hard one to talk into bow hunting. And finally he accidentally put in for an antelope tag that was an archery only tag.
Oh,
and he drew it. So he said, well, I guess I'm going to go bow hunting this year. I need to get a bow. So we bought one of my old bows and then decided, well, I'll try and go deer and elk hunting with you. Well, that was another one of the years where I just didn't have much time to go because I had other plans later in the year. He got his deer the day we went elk hunting. We went for 2 days and he got his white, a big mule deer doe. He thought that was pretty cool. And then I had one day that I could hunt antelope with him. And I said, well, go out there and check it out, see what you see. And then we'll go out there on this one day. I'll help you. And then you can hunt there by yourself after that. Anyways, he comes back with a picture of a buck that was, you know, just a nice white, a nice antelope buck. And he said, this is the one I want to get. He's kind of got a gimp on his leg. It looks like maybe somebody had already shot at him and he had a cut on his lower leg, you know? I was like, okay, the chances of us finding that are almost zero. Antelope just don't stay in one spot very good, you know? And so we go out there and we're looking around and there's just not many antelope out there that time when we're doing spot and stalk. And as we're heading down this one ridge into a big flat meadow where there was some water, the coyotes started howling really good. And we're just walking. And I mean, they're only 300 yards away from us and they're just howling like crazy. And he goes, you want to shoot a coyote? And I was like, what do you mean? I was like, you want to try with your bow and I'll call for you. He goes, yeah, that's what I want. And I was like, oh man, that's tough. Spot and stalk. We're going to call in a coyote. Anyways, we found a spot. We sat up. I called this coyote in. So his first coyote, he shot it at 20 yards with his bow on a call in. And then later that day, when we were hiking back, we hadn't gotten antelope. We got back to where we parked the vehicle and we kind of threw our packs on the ground. And the buck antelope that he had been wanting to shoot stood up about 400 yards away and started walking towards the vehicle. So we hid behind, his truck and it walked past us a couple hundred yards and down the draw and it laid down and bedded down again. So anyways, we snuck up on that and he shot that too. So in like 3 days of hunting, he's already got a deer, a nice antelope buck, and a coyote on a call in with a bow. And so he was like, man, this is so easy. He's like, I can't believe how easy bow hunting is. And I was like, don't kid yourself. Like,
yeah,
like, the stars are probably aren't going to align like that again for a while. So
right.
Anyways, it was really fun. I mean, he had a super good time, but I think it took him almost 3 years after that to get another animal with the bow. And he was trying pretty hard, you know, but it was kind of perfect circumstance. And then I was close enough to him. I was able to kind of tell him what to do. And it just worked out. Like, I don't know how to explain it any other way. Like, the stars aligned perfectly for him that year. And yeah. He got more experience in 2 days than anybody else gets in, you know, 3 years of hunting. So.
Oh yeah. And you know, you like to see, you know, new hunters, you know, get these nice animals, but you know, it's going to ruin them. Because now they're going to expect to get it every time. And, you know, some of us started out, you know, seeing a footprint in the dirt was a good day. Yeah. You know, that meant at least there was a deer at some point in this area.
Yep. And I think that's, you know, that's how it usually goes. A lot of guys spent, you know, a lot of years hunting and just trying to get a shot at a deer or something. So if a guy doesn't have a lot of experience already hunting, I usually tell him, don't wait for a big buck. Don't try and get a big giant 6-point bull elk, you know, just shoot a spike or a small bull or a cow, shoot something. Because it seems like to me, after they've done it once, they become a lot better at it really quick.
Right.
But if you're never taking a shot and you're never trying, you don't get the experience that you need sometimes. And then you end up hunting for 7 or 10 years before you kill something, you know. And not everybody wants to shoot a doe, but I try pretty hard to get a new hunter. I'm just like, just get one. Just don't worry too much about what it is and get one and get that under your belt and the whole experience. And it will improve your hunting after that a lot. Like, you just become a better hunter by doing it. So,
well, and I generally hunt for the does. You know, if a buck comes by, that's a bonus.
Right.
You know,
yep.
You know, the does actually generally taste better.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Than the bucks. You can't eat the rack, and it's kind of expensive because you got to do something to rack. If it's a nice rack, if it's a crappy looking rack, then you just cut it off and use it for whatever. And, we do have a comment in from the group. For those listening, if you don't already know, the Arch Talk 101 Facebook group gets to do this live and they can interact with us. Jim says, past my prime for elk hunting, but it sounds like such a great challenge, especially with traditional equipment. He's a traditional archer, so he doesn't have the compound. He's got, the stick and the string, and it would definitely be a challenge. You got to look closer.
Yeah. I've actually met some guys. I haven't hunted them a lot myself with traditional archery. I just got into compounds when I was a kid, so that's what I've done. But he actually preferred using traditional archery equipment. He got rid of all of his compound stuff because wherever he was calling, it was pretty thick. And he said he didn't have enough time to draw that bow back and aim. And the last time I talked to that guy, he was 5 for 5 years in a row. And the farthest one he shot was 7 yards. So, I don't know where he was hunting, but he was calling him. I mean, he said, I don't know. He's like, I don't know how anybody gets one with a compound bow because you can't aim. He's like, they just run you over when you call. And I'm like, he's one of those guys that naturally just calls real good right off the bat, And anyways, he had 5 bulls in a row with traditional archery, and the farthest one was 7 yards. Like he's like, literally, I drop back and just put it right on them and shoot them, and they're 5 feet from me, So I don't know. I haven't had that trouble with bulls, but most of the elk that I've shot are bulls. They're all usually under 25 yards. So yeah, but usually if it's going to work out, it works out pretty good.
Yeah. Now when they come in close. I've had deer, in that real close range, and where I can see the hair changing colors when the broadhead slices through the hair. The underside is kind of gray and the outside is kind of a reddish color, when it's hunting season. And I've seen the hair turn gray when the broadhead sliced through the outer layer of the hair.
Right.
And yeah, that's close.
Yeah. It's fun. I think if you practice your calling, traditional archery equipment, it's definitely doable. So yeah, it's more of a challenge, I guess, because a lot of guys will shoot a long ways with a compound bow. I try to keep it pretty short range, but yeah, it's definitely doable. Getting the thick stuff with them and call at them, and you'll have elk come right by you. So
I've seen some videos where the animals basically coming up and sniffing the tip of the broadhead,
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, I haven't had bulls do that to me, but I've had cows and calves do that plenty of times. Just right up to me. They're just looking you right in the face from 5-6 feet away and looking around trying to figure out what's making that noise. They walk away and you make another sound and they turn around and come back and stand there again. And it's pretty cool. But if I was hunting with traditional equipment, I would be shooting those cows. I would go ahead and shoot one with the traditional equipment. I mean, I think that's just another step past where the compounds and stuff are. So
yeah, you need a little bit longer range, a little more power. But you know, when you're shooting a big heavy arrow, don't have to go fast.
Yeah, no, it works just fine. You just wait for a good angle and shoot them, it'll get them.
Well, and even on a compound, my very first shot I was able to take at a deer that I took at a deer was about 5 years in. And I'd set up, there was some brush on between me and the trail that I expected to walk down. And I had to get up about 20 feet in the air in order to get over it, to shoot over it. And when I shot that arrow, that deer turned around and it was hanging. I think it almost went all the way through up to the fletching, and I was shooting 52 pounds. That's back when aluminum arrows, before carbons come out, and it was a 21-17 full length, 145 grain tip. I don't know what that thing weighed, but it was heavy. And out of 52 pounds, I almost went clean through that deer. And,
yeah.
You don't need a lot of speed and power. Now my bow, now I'm shooting a quite a bit lighter arrow. It's right about 400 grains for my hunting arrows, and at 70 pounds, you know, I got some pretty good speed out of it.
Yeah. I mean, I've been shooting long enough that I remember carbon arrows coming out, and I remember the hours spent trying to tune, you know, a broadhead to an aluminum arrow, heating up the glue and rolling them on the roller, trying to get them to cool where they were straight, because there was just too much play. It's not like a carbon arrow where you slide it on and roll it. And if it's straight, it's straight. If it's not, it could be the outsert, you know, or insert or whatever. And that you can just change that. But I probably shot 20 animals with a bow with aluminum arrows, and big heavy ones. I mean, I shot a lot of pounds for a little while. I mean, 25 14s and 440 grain four blade broadheads and 5-inch feathers on them, and all kinds of things trying to make them shoot straight, you know. So, but yeah, it's a lot different now.
Yeah, I used to shoot the double X78s, which was the straightest aluminum you could get at the time.
Yeah,
of course, back then it was like $65 a dozen for those, where you could get the cheaper ones for like 30. So I was paying double, you know, almost double the price for them. But, you know, the straighter the shaft, the tighter the grooves.
Yep.
And when you're trying to send a broadhead down there, and, you know, and you're tweaking, and like you said, you know, you line of fletching up, and then I was shooting a four blade. So it kind of a little bit different that time. And then I said switch to three blades, and then you line up the fletching even with it. And, you know, that's how you get the most, you know, the best flight out of them. That's what I found with the aluminum. And yeah, heating them up and twisting them a little bit, heat them up, twist them a little bit. And then if you go too far, you got to turn about, you know, 120 degrees, 270 or something, you know, turn to the next set of and try it again, because you can't really back them out, because now you're loosening the broadhead up. And
It was such a funny, I think about it compared to what we do now. And it's just, it's kind of funny. Like I spent hours trying to get six arrows straight enough that I could shoot a good group at 40 yards, you know?
Yeah.
And
I've done the same thing with carbon arrows. You know, you can still tune the broadhead so they group the same. You know, if you have like I was shooting 100 grain muzzies with three blades, and I would line up the fletching, the two fletching with the two blades of the broadhead, because it was a three blade. I'd line them up, and they'd be off a little bit. Now those, you glue the inserts in. You're not heating them up to move them.
No,
they're not able to be taken out like that. So what they come up with is something called a U-bar, which is a cone-shaped washer. And then you would put that on your broadhead with an O-ring between the shaft and the broadhead. So that cone-shaped washer, you would crank it down, and now you could tighten it up or loosen it up a little bit, and you could do that fine tuning that we used to do by heating up the aluminum, you know, the hot melt glue. We could do it. So you'd tune them in there, and you know, I got where I could group my arrows tight enough that I could hit X's with my broadheads.
Right. Yep.
But don't shoot field tips out of that bow, because they don't come anywhere close. Right. But I didn't care, because I knew my broadheads were hitting where I needed.
Right. Exactly. It's hard. Like, I tune my broadheads and my field points to shoot pretty close to the same now, but I'm not really worried about it. Like most guys, even guys that come into the shop, they want them to be exactly the same. And it's hard to understand, or it's hard to get for me to worry very much about that, because I'm like, man, you don't remember what we used to go through. As long as the broadhead shoots really, really good, I don't really care if my field points are 3 inches to the right, you know what I mean? Or left or wherever. But I spend quite a bit of time helping guys get their field points to shoot the same, because that gives them some sort of comfort. So, but it's not the same as the way it was, you know. It was definitely a lot more work and a lot more time involved in trying to get things to work right. So,
And I can remember one time when I was trying to get the most consistent, most accurate arrow I could. And, you know, with the double X78s, you know, they're 0015 straightness. And I'm figuring, okay, I want the total weight of the arrow. And I'm doing field tips. I want the total weight of the arrow to be exactly the same, because they're going to leave at the exact same speed. So now my drop should be exactly the same, you know. And so I went through and I fletched my arrows, had their insert in there, and I weighed the shaft, and I took and I wrote on the shaft how many grains it weighed. So I knew how much that weighed, and then I knew the variation there. And then I took all my, because having the store, I'd buy my points in a 100 bag. And so I'd go through and weigh all my points until I could match them up so they're all the same. Now, some of them I couldn't get quite close, so I'm filing the back of the insert before I glue it in. So yeah. I got a whole dozen arrows with field tips with it, no, with a half a grain from one end to the other end.
Wow.
I did it once.
Yeah. I mean, if you've been doing archery long enough and you work on your own stuff at all, you go through all kinds of trying rabbit holes, I guess, trying to figure out how to make everything work better. Did you find that helped a whole bunch with your accuracy or not?
No. Because yeah. At that time I wasn't that good of a shot, you know. I was still working on developing my skills and stuff, but
yeah.
You know, I didn't notice really any real difference in that. You know, that was one of those things that, you know, you go through and try, and the amount of work it was, it wasn't worth the effort I put into it for the results I was getting.
Right.
You know, when, now if you can see, okay, I'm getting dead center in the X, dead center in the X with this setup, and without that setup, I'm keeping them in the X.
Right.
You know, then, okay, is it worth it? Well, yeah, because maybe one would come out if keep them in that dead center right on that little spot in the middle.
But, right.
Now I grab a 100 grain point and I screw it on my arrow and go.
Yeah, that's how I am.
I don't weigh my finished arrows. I don't weigh my tips. It's at the range we're shooting at 20 yards or less.
Yeah.
You can be shooting 10 grains difference and won't know the difference.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. I mean, the only time I think I would consider that is if I was going to shoot on a professional level, you know, and be really competing, then I would be like, okay, if it saved me, you know, a line one time, then it might be worth it.
Right.
But in general, I think it doesn't matter. I mean, as long as it's close, it'll be fine.
You know, for hunting situations, you don't know the exact yardage. You got a pretty good close guess. Now, if you use one of those range finders, you know the exact yardage, but you still got you got an animal that's moving on you.
Yeah.
So they can easily take a stab and be off. But
yep.
Yeah, if you're looking at, you're competing in a 300 round and the winning scores are 300.
Yeah.
All the top scores are 300. Who wins with the most number of X's?
Yep.
And, you know, if you can get one more X, that might mean you win. So yeah. There I can see somebody that's at that level, the, you know, the
yes.
top levels, the professional levels, or, you know, your Olympic levels, and, you know, those might be worthwhile to have, you know, one more X, you know,
right.
or two more X's because their arrows yeah. are much closer.
An inside X instead of an outside X, or just
right.
that little tiny difference that made the difference, you know. But yeah, in general, I don't think that's a necessary thing to do for most people.
No. What I remember one time when I was in one archery club, we had a broadhead sighting in day. So we had a broadhead target out about 10 yards. It wasn't near our regular backstop because it was a cardboard one and you didn't want broadhead sticking a cardboard target. But one, you may not get them out.
Right.
And two, it does tear them up. So we had a broadhead target, 10 yards. I was amazed at how many people couldn't hit the 2-foot square target. Yeah. And they're going to go hunt. And it's like, okay, we need to fix something here. And it's amazing how many people just don't spend the time to get good at it.
Right.
Or even if you don't have the time to go shoot a lot, you at least need to know proper form.
You know,
get with an instructor, you know, like myself or any of the other instructors that can help you get that form. Because if you got that form, you can get back and shoot really good, you know, with the proper form in a short period of time.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, that's what, yeah. Well, being having a shop, you got guys who want a paper tune, some guys don't even want to shoot through the paper. They just want you to paper tune it, which doesn't mean that for them it's going to be a bullet hole, but you get so many guys that they want to shoot through the paper, but they don't have any form. They've just got a bow and they bought it with their buddies and they've been shooting for the last 5 years and they just can't do it. They don't have good enough form. So we spend tons and tons of time helping people with their form, just trying to get them to where they can shoot an arrow the right way and that they know
right.
What it feels like. Because I feel like when you're shooting a broadhead, when shooting field points, you can get away with your gripping your bow a little bit or not having your hand at the right spot. And you can shoot okay. You can feel like you can hit a target. But as soon as you put broadheads on there, all the little different pressures and the different things that you do, it opens your group up significantly all of a sudden. So for hunting, like I feel like you should be able to make the best shot that you can. And it's worth going right. and getting your bow tuned right and getting enough instruction so that you have proper form and you can actually shoot an arrow that's going to go straight, you know
right.
what I mean? So
and I've seen some that, you know, where proper form gets good tear, bad form, you get a bad tear and you can't get it out because it's their form causing it.
Yes.
And I had one guy come in and he just couldn't group with his bow and he thought, okay, it's gotta be the rest. So he wanted to put a dropway rest on it. So I put a drop ray rest on it. And what do you got to do with a drop ray rest? You got to shoot it, see if it's set up right, right?
Yeah.
So I go in the range. There's one of the other guys is in there helping somebody else. And there's a guy sitting, one or got two guys sitting back there just kind of watching. And I go in, I take the first and I shot. It's like, well, not too bad. Try another. Boom. Robin Hood and arrow. And the guy says, I've never seen anybody do this. Like, yeah. Well, that's the second one I've got working at the archery store. And I got like six others. You know, I quit shooting single spots just for that reason, because you know, busting knocks all the time. And, you just don't want to do that. And then the guy told me, you know, I could not group shooting this bow at all. And the first thing he thinks, well, dude, it's you. Because I just stuck two arrows together. I put them in the same hole.
and it's really hard. Some people are easy to tell that to, and some are not as easy.
Yeah. But I didn't say it that way, but.
Yeah.
I'm a little more tactful.
Yeah. it really makes a giant difference. Like it, like your grip on your bow is probably your first thing that I think needs to be right. And then the second thing, you got to have an anchor point. And then from there you can start working on your trigger and letting an arrow go right. You know, but you've got to get a couple of things straight first. You got to start building your foundation somewhere. And I think got to get your grip first so that you're not torquing the bow or grabbing it or twisting it or whatever. And then, you know, you start back. And I really try to teach people not to, like, you get the guy who's new and he wants his arrows to hit in the middle of the target. And when you're brand new, it's okay to sight your bow in. But if your arrows are 3 inches to the right today, and then you move your sight and then you come back tomorrow and you're a little bit different. So now you're 2 inches low, and it's not anything to do with the bow at all. It's just a matter of learning to be consistent enough to shoot. I mean, I've watched guys for months chase their sights around and I'm trying to tell them, you know, stop doing that. Just don't move your sights and just shoot for 2 weeks and try to do it the same way every time. And until they do that, they never can get their bow sighted in because they're just all over the place, you know. I say all over the place. They're 2 inches one way and then they're 2 inches that way. And those are inconsistencies usually in the archer that cause all of that.
Right. I know I've gone through and you know, it's like there's no target to shoot at. It's just a blank backstop. Mm-hmm. Shoot. You hit the black backstop, you're good. You miss the backstop, we're going to talk about what you're doing drastically wrong. But hit the backstop anywhere. Doesn't matter where it goes. And then work on that. I know when I first learned back tension release, we shot with our eyes closed. There's like 10 or 15 of us, something like that. Just standing close enough to the backstop that we can lean forward, grab there and pull it back out. And we're shooting with our eyes closed just to learn the form. And, you know, and it's amazing how many times once you open your eyes, your form goes crap. And there's no target to shoot at. It's just a blank. it all looks the same because it's all just edge of the cardboard. And then you close your eyes until you finally do it. And, you know, now you do it enough that, you know, there's techniques that I use if my form goes to crap that I can fix. And one of the things I use, I have a string that's the length of my drawing. I put it around my thumb and I can shoot. And when my form is correct, that string jumps straight off my hand to the target. If it doesn't do that, my form's off. So I keep working on that. And I can work on that without having a bow in my hand.
Yeah, you know? We do that with some people. If we get somebody who's really struggling, I go back there and get them a piece of string and try to tie it in knots so that it's the right length for them and say, go home and watch TV and practice. You know what I mean? Like, you don't have to shoot arrows. You can sit here and try to get everything right. And it actually improves some people a lot. Like, they come back in a couple of weeks and I'm like, wow, that really helped a lot. So, yeah.
When your string hits your TV, you know you did it right.
Yep. Right. Yeah. It's funny. Yeah. The amount of time that you spend learning how to do it. And like you were saying, like, you still find yourself, maybe you didn't shoot for 2 weeks or something because you had a bunch of things going on, and you come back and you've got a little problem with your form, and you have to fix it again over and over and over again. Right. It seems like no matter how good you get, you're always working on something. You know what I mean? You're like, okay, I'm pushing into the heel of my bow, or I'm not letting it go right. So the thing that I like to tell people is to try to practice to make it feel like everything worked just right.
Right.
Like everything happened just the way you wanted it. And then you can really start working on your groups, and then you can get stuff to work real well, some, you know, in general.
Yeah. A process to go through.
Yeah.
One of the things that I used to do is, you know, guys shooting at the target, and he just all, you know, they're all over the place around the target. So I'll take like a 1-inch wide black, you know, electrical tape or something, put it up there, put it on the backstop horizontal. Mm-hmm. I says, okay, now, or a marker or something, anyway, just make this horizontal line that's about an inch thick, and put it on a horizontal line. And now I tell them, shoot the line, doesn't care where you're at, shoot the line. And then they're going through, and then, you know, it's amazing how they're going to hit that line most of the time. Okay. Now I turn the line, and instead of being horizontal, make it vertical. That's amazing how much they hit that line. This is, well, you've now just hit a 1-inch circle. You just proved to yourself that no matter where it is horizontally, you can hit that 1-inch wide line, or vertical, you hit that 1-inch wide line. Your X-ring is only a 1-inch diameter circle.
Yeah.
You should be able to put every shot in that X-ring. Like, oh, yeah. You know, it builds their confidence that, you know, they can do it, because your mind will let you float across that horizontal or vertical line.
Yeah.
You know, and you don't think about it, and then go and,
yeah.
Well, I tell the, you know, people when I find out they're an archer, and I said, you use a wrist release. And yeah, that's okay. I'm giving you first lesson for free. Quit pulling the trigger. Like, how do you know I'm doing that? I've taught too many people. You're doing that.
Yeah. That's the battle that that takes a lot of working on your mind to get through the trigger the right way. And to make it all happen right. It's archery is a battle with yourself, is what it is. It's a mental game. It's a mental game that we play with ourselves. And that's why I think that's why so many people, it's like therapy for yourself. You know what I mean? You go out there and all you're doing is working on your own mind and doing things right. And you can let everything else go. And you're just in your own little world.
Yeah.
Out there shooting your bow, trying to do things perfect, you know? And it's a never ending struggle. No matter how much we shoot or how good we get, we're still working on something. So,
yeah, you know, if you can take the center of that X where the two lines cross and hit it 100% of the time, you're not getting any better. But I don't know of anybody that can do that 100% of the time.
Nope. But sometimes we hit it 15 times in a row, you know, and
that makes you
feel pretty good. So, yeah, that's it's I don't know. It's fun. I just, archery is just a fun thing that I was lucky, like getting into archery. For me, it was always fun. And my uncle was always like, well, come watch me. And he gave me, I mean, I wore out all the old archery junk he had, right? If you've been doing archery, you've got a closet full of stuff. It's just junk, you know? And I mean, I don't know how many dozens of arrows he came up with for me to buy from him for nothing almost, or gave to me when I was learning to hunt between like 13 and 15. I mean, I planted arrows all over the mountain. You know, I shot at every deer I saw. I learned all kinds of lessons. It took me like a couple of years to get one with a bow, but I was always trying, you know, somehow I made a bad shot here or there, but finally, I got one. I think when I was 15, that was when I got the first deer with a bow. And then after that, it was all over. I've shot something with a bow every year, I think, since then. So archery should be fun. Hunting should be fun, and we should be enjoying it. And I have a hard time when I see people that are not doing that. I had my kids out 2 years ago, two of my kids, and we got into it. It was the first bull elk that they got into, and actually had a chance to try and shoot it. And it was a big one, you know, it was a really big 6x7. And I didn't even have a tag. I was just helping them. And they both came really close to getting a shot. And they were both really mad and started arguing after it was over. Because, you know, they were blaming each other for not getting the elk. And I'm like, you guys, if you want to come back out here and you want to hunt elk with me, like, we're having fun. I was like, I had so much fun trying to get that elk. And you're definitely not going to kill all the elk you see with the bow. Just never going to happen. You're going to go through 10 of them before you get one, you know? So anyways, they thought about that. They were quiet for a while. And since then we've had a lot better hunts, but they were really arguing about it. I mean, that's your fault. I didn't get that, you know? And I was like, no, that is not what we're going to do on an elk hunt. You know, like,
no,
make mistakes and we had fun and, you know, let's go try another one. You know? So,
yeah. Cause that makes it no fun for you and you don't want to take them out. Yeah, that's all they're going to do.
Yeah, that's what I told them. I was like, hey, I want to have fun. That's why I came out here. So if you guys want to have fun, let's go hunting. Otherwise, I'm not going to bring you back. Because I do this for fun and to relax and, you know, to forget about everything else and have a good time. So, yeah.
Yeah, the thing about archery is you have to relax to shoot it. Because if you're stressed about something, thinking about something else, you're not going to shoot very good at all. And then you get more upset. Yeah. It's like, better off and just not shoot that day.
Yeah, no, and there's days where you just put it down and don't shoot. Like, you shoot a few and if it's really not happening, you should just walk away. So,
yeah.
Yep. Yeah, that's one thing you learn after you screw it up enough times. You don't want bad practice.
It's just like, you know, when I was first starting the Archstock 101 Facebook group, you know, I wanted to cater to helping archers out. You know, that's why I called it Arch Talk 101. And I actually started the podcast first. And then it's like, I was challenged to put a podcast out, you know, once a month. And then it's, we'll do it 2 months. I said, okay, I'll do two. Now what do I do it on? Oh, well, archery. I can talk about archer all day long. You know, so I started out. And then the first thing I did was I put out a little checklist for new archers that have never been to an archery store. What do you look for when you go there? You know, what do you need to know? And when you go into an archery store, what should they be asking you? So at least they know. It's like, if they're not asking you, you know, check and see what your dominant eye is, because that makes a difference for your right or left-handed bow, and why you're doing it.
Yeah.
You know, is it just for fun, or do you watch 100 games and you're like, oh, that'd be cool? Do you want a recurve? You want a compound, longbow, a crossbow? Yep. You know, what is it you're looking to get out of it? Is it just, hey, I just want to fling arrows in the backyard once in a while and just shoot my bow? It's like, okay, get yourself a recurve, much more simple. And, you know, a lot of my traditional archers, like, that's the only one to use. But you know, you got to look at what is it that you want to go for. It's like, okay, well, I'd like to compete. Well, what do you want to compete in?
Yeah.
You know, and those are all things that, you know, you're going to have to find out from a new archer, you know, and then fit them with the right bow. And then I always told them, okay, now if you're right-handed, you're going to grab the right-hand bows, your left-handed will grab the left-handed bows. But grab a bow, put it in your hand. Does it feel good? No, put it back up. Okay, that feels good. Okay. Now any other feel good? yeah, this one feels good. Okay, let's go shoot those two.
Yeah.
And then don't let them do more than two bows at a time. I found out the hard way. I had six bows one time laying on the floor of this guy shooting. And finally, I says, you know, he couldn't figure out which one he wanted. So I says, okay, close your eyes, shoot this bow. Okay, now take that from him, give him the next one. Okay, shoot it. You shoot with the eyes closed. So, you know, we don't have to worry because I was watching, make sure nobody come in the range from behind us and walked up in front. And, you know, he's at least pointing at the backstop. And it's okay, which one do you like the best and why? Says, well, I like this one better because I can't care less what his reason why. I just wanted him to say it.
You know,
I wanted them to say why they liked it better. Now, okay, the one they liked the best, I keep that one. And then I go grab two more of them, two different ones.
Right.
Shoot this one. Which one like better? Now I have the ones he likes and go through the last two. Which one like better? Now I grab those two. Which one do you like the best? And then you're like, okay, this is your bow.
Yep.
There's his eyes closed. You know, no loyalty to brand. And, you know, I used to have people come in and say, well, so I'm going to get the best. Well, what's that? Matthew.
Yeah. That's a hard question right there. Yeah.
The advertisements say they're the best.
Yeah.
They're used a lot because they used to be one of the only ones that paid you extra to win with their bow, which is a great marketing ploy. You know, a professional archer is going to win no matter what bow they have. They can anybody's bow.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
But if you're a professional, you're doing this for the money as well as fun. But if you can get an extra $2,000, $5,000 for taking first place with the Matthews bow over somebody else's, aren't you going to take the extra money?
Right.
Now, there are some that, you know, they like this bow and they don't care if they don't pay as much. This is the bow they like and that's what you should do. And, you know, those come in with an open mind. I used to get in my PSEs all the time.
Those
without an open mind, you're not getting them out of there. And I didn't try. You know, the Hoyt shooters were a little bit different, but now there's, you know, that was before Elite come out and Bowtech, I don't think was around. Your Diamond Bows wasn't around. And there's other one, Elite. All those are bows that didn't exist back when I was first started in this, you know, 23 years ago or 22 years ago.
Yeah,
they didn't exist. And in fact, carbons were just coming out. And the very first carbons had outserts on it, and the carbon fibers are laid from the nock to the tip in that orientation. And when they broke, they shattered, basically exploded fiberglass fragments all over.
Yeah.
Or carbon fiber fragments all over. And it's like, there's no way I'm going to shoot a carbon arrow. There's no way.
Yeah. It was. When those arrows came out, I remember seeing guys shoot deer and, you know, there's a spot that big through the deer that there's just carbon all over the place in that meat. You just about couldn't eat any of it because you didn't know where the stuff went, you know? So we were pretty leery of carbon for quite a while when it first came out.
Yeah. And then they come out with the cross weave where you're running horizontal and vertical and lay that out, and those, they snap clean. And then POs that come up with their X-weave, which is actually looks like little, instead of being horizontal vertical, they actually go crosswise.
Yeah.
You know, like that's what we call the X, because if you look down the shaft, they look like a bunch of X's. And those are a real tough shaft as well. And, you know, there I took one night when I was at my range, you know, how tough some of those arrows are, at least your better quality ones. I was shooting at my broadhead target at my range, and I was tired after working all day long. And I missed and hit the concrete wall.
Yeah.
With a muzzy broadhead.
Oh boy.
And I go up there and the shaft is laying on the ground, the muzzy broadhead sticking in a concrete block. I reach up and it had the muzzy broadhead with half the insert on it. The other half had broken, was in the shaft. And I think it was broke. I don't remember now, but I pulled the broadhead out of the concrete block and looked at it. Not a bit of damage on that point.
Jeez.
I still have the broadhead. I don't even know which one it is anymore because I never marked it. So I still have that broadhead. Didn't even mess it up. So I pick up the shaft and it was cracked that back about an inch.
Yeah.
So I cut it off and let my kid use it.
Yeah. I'm surprised. Like, we shoot a little bit of 3D, or I don't know what you call it. It's only 20 yards, but we set 3D targets up and have a bow shoot every year. But we always have some bonus targets, which are, you know, 3/8-inch thick steel, and they've got about an inch and a quarter hole in them for double points, or lose your arrow and get normal points, you know. Anyways, there's some arrows, like one that surprises me is the Black Eagle Deep Impact.
Right. That
arrow, even though it's got an aluminum outsert, I've seen bows that set at about 60 pounds, 65 pounds. We had one arrow hit that steel plate, I think, 12 times in a row before it bent the outsert or broke the arrow. All it was doing was shooting the nocks out the back.
Oh, that's a tough shaft.
Yeah, it's really tough. And some of the other arrows are that tough, but not for whatever reason, the way the design of that outsert is, it's really tough. Like, it shocks me. It'll bend because it's aluminum, but it's
right.
It's really tough. But it's some of like your Victory TKOs, if those hit it right, if it doesn't break the outsert, it usually won't break the arrow. Like, the arrow will survive like the deep impact. I mean, it's kind of crazy. Like, watching the steel get shot hundreds of times is it's educational anyways. So, but yeah, there's some stuff out there that it's surprisingly tough. Like, you're not going to shoot it into a bone on an animal. It's not going to break, you know. If it hits sideways, it would, but not straight on. So,
yeah. And I've hit thigh bones with my Muzzy, and it still went through, shattered the bone. And, you know, fortunately you catch an artery and, you know, they're going to die, but otherwise it's just all limping around. But,
right.
Yeah. That Muzzy, but the only thing I haven't been able to go through is that part of that shoulder blade that has that big bone on it.
Yeah.
It don't go through that, but it'll go through the other part of the shoulder blade.
Yeah.
A little bit lower one.
Yeah. There's all kinds of stories with all kinds of broadheads going through all kinds of bones, and there's all kinds of stories where they didn't. So
yeah,
I tell everybody, don't try it. Don't count on that working aim in a good spot. Cause yeah, you don't want to hit bones if you can help it, for sure.
Well, the rib bones are kind of the bone that would, if you hit any of them, that's going to be the one that you would most likely get. And
yeah,
a good durable broadhead's going to go through them.
Yeah. Those bones are fine, but yeah, shoulder bones and everything else, I try not to hit them if I can help it.
Yeah. Yeah. That's not good when you hit one of them shoulder bones. And now the shoulder blade itself, you know, I go through them fairly often and, you know, no problems with that, but you know, it's a little bit softer.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. About like a rib bone.
Yeah. Yeah, you hit the right part of that. It goes through pretty good. So. Yep.
Yeah, that's a lot of interesting stories. You got some, you know, I figured, you know, looking at your profile, it's like, you're going to have some cool stories. And I was right.
Yeah, no, I've almost been doing archery as long as you have. And I've shot a lot of stuff with a bow. I mean, one other thing I think that people don't realize happens is how fast animals move. You know, I used to take a lot longer shots, and I'm perfectly capable of making good long shots, but animals don't hold still, and so you see bad things happen taking long shots. And then I went to Africa one time and I shot a zebra. And the zebra was only at 23 yards and, you know, it's coming into a water hole, so it's going to give me a good shot sooner or later. And the guide said, can you hit the spot? And I'm like, from here? Yeah, I can hit the spot. I can hit a quarter on the zebra. You just tell me where you want me to hit it. So he told me where he wanted to hit it. And I shot, and you could see my arrow hit that into that black line right in the perfect spot, you know, and the zebra kind of leaned towards the tank and ran away. Well, the zebra just kept running away. Like, it never stopped. And so the guide's like, I don't know what happened. You know, like that arrow hit a good spot. I was like, oh yeah, it hit the spot you told me to shoot at, you know. Anyways, so he said, well, would you be willing to shoot it with a rifle now that you've shot it? And I'm like, of course I would. I want to know exactly what happened. However we can get it, let's go get it, you know. So they, you know, we got the rifle out and we jumped in the truck and drove across the desert for a mile and finally found it and shot it. And what had happened was, as you go back and you watch the video, and that zebra, when I shot, it was trying to get out of the way or jump in the string or whatever. It laid completely sideways on top of that water tank. It happened faster than you could see. So that arrow still hit the same place, but it stayed between the ribs and the hide inside. It never went inside the chest cavity, all the way to the backbone. So there was about this much arrow sticking out of the spot that I needed to hit. But it never hit anything that mattered. It didn't do anything. I mean, eventually that arrow would have fallen out and the zebra would have probably lived with us with a broadhead in his, you know, his backbone. But I mean, how would you ever see that happen? Like, we didn't know what happened till after the whole thing was over. And I'm like, they're like, well, let's go inside and eat dinner. I'm like, no, I'm going over there where the butcher is. I want to see, you know, what happened to that thing.
Right.
And then after I saw it, I'm like, well, how'd that happen? And I went back and started watching the video and slowed it down. And, you know, it's just crazy. But it's not always that you made a bad shot. It's not always that you screwed up. It's not that you had a bad broadhead. It's just you're hunting a wild animal and they don't hold still. And they're trying not to get killed.
Right. So,
you know,
and who would have thought it would have laid over sideways?
Yeah, I mean, it was completely horizontal on top of the tank, and you didn't see it happen. It just laid down and gone, you know. And we were just all like, why is the zebra still, why is that thing still going across the desert, you know what I mean? Anyways, it was pretty interesting. But that, I mean, you don't always want to be hard on yourself about the shot and everything that happened, because we can't even see always what happens. You just do the very best you can, and you know, hopefully they don't move is the real challenge a lot of the time. So,
well, you said you're what, 23 yards away?
Yeah. Yep. 23 yards.
And that's not even a long shot.
No. And I was shooting, that bow was shooting about 311 feet a second with that arrow. I mean, that's fast, you know?
Right. That's
a screaming fast arrow for a hunting arrow, and at 23 yards it still managed to move that much. So yeah, crazy.
Yeah, like I said, that's crazy that it could do that much movement in that short period of time. From the time that it heard the sound and the arrow got there, it laid over horizontal.
Yes.
And just basically got a scratch.
Yeah, I mean, it bled quite a bit because I had a flesh wound, but it wasn't going to die from it for sure, you know, like it would have lived. Yeah, it would have lived and gone on. But I really wanted to know what happened, like how in the world, like I made a perfect shot, you know what? And in your mind, you want to blame your broadheads. What did my bow screw up? You know, what happened? Well, nothing happened. It was a really good shot. I mean, hit the spot, the broadhead worked perfectly, the arrow worked perfectly, the bow worked perfectly, but the animal moved and it was faster than I could see, you know,
yeah.
It was unreal how fast that thing, when you watch the video and you realize how far it really went, you're just like, how in the world did he move that fast? You know?
Yeah.
Big animal. I mean, they're big, you know, it wasn't a little rabbit sized critter that like lightning fast. It was a big one. So,
well, zebras kind of, you know, size of a horse and
yeah, you know, oh yeah, are... they're big, they're great big boned. I mean, between the hide and the inside of the rib cage in places, it was that thick. Like,
oh,
it was pretty crazy. And we're talking like 4 inches thick, you know what I mean? I was like, wow.
So, that's a lot to get through.
Yeah, I mean, it made it, you think about going from where the heart would be all the way to the backbone between two ribs, and it never broke out of either side. Like it stayed between all the way up. I mean, it's kind of crazy because it's not even straight, but there was enough zebra to keep that broadhead in between all the way to the backbone. So yeah. Kind of crazy stuff. Sometimes you just can't help it. Like you're going to have, it's just going to go wrong. I mean, it happens with rifles too, but it just, you can't always help it. You do your best and hope for the best, you know, but.
Well, when you think about, you know, those, the longer the range, the more apt they have to do that, because the speed of sound is way faster than your arrow.
Right.
Now on some of your rifles, you know, depending on the speed of that, you're getting closer, but you're still going to hear the sound before the bullet gets there. And not by much, but you do have a little bit more impact, but you get far enough away though, and the sound, they don't notice the sound, but that's why, we like to have our bows quiet. And if you take a compound bow and trying to get the fastest bow you have, they're loud.
Yeah.
They make a lot of noise, not like a crossbow, but still they're pretty loud. And I'd much rather have a quieter one. And that's why, on mine, I put the Sims string leeches on them. On my string on the top and the bottom. I put it on my cable. I have a control cable, and the other one's just a single string, but I'll put it on the string. I'll put it on the cables. I'll take and pluck the string, and you hear that little high pitched twang. And I put the dampener in it, and it's a kind of a thud. Well, that's quieter bow, but you know what? It slows my bow down.
Yeah.
But you know what? I don't care.
Yeah. It's funny. When I was younger, we didn't have a lot of whitetail in our area. Now we have some, but I drove up to Northern Idaho, and there was a lot of whitetail up there. Cause I decided I wanted to get a whitetail with a bow, so I went up there and we got set up, and over the course of 5 days, I better back up. So I went up there 1 year, last day of archery season, missed a really nice buck. He jumped the string at 40 yards. And he was a really nice one. So the next year I was like, okay, I'm gonna go get me a quieter bow. I don't care how fast it goes. I'm gonna go back up there and I'm gonna get that thing, And so I went back with the quietest bow I could find and the quietest arrows. Everything was as quiet as it could be. And in 5 days, I missed 7 bucks. The farthest one was 27 yards. They all jumped the string. I mean, I aim low, they jump up in the air. I aim high, or I tried everything. It was so frustrating. I went back with my rifle that year and got one. But sometimes you just, if they're all on edge because there's a mountain lion or something around, it's almost like you can't hit them no matter what you do. I couldn't believe it. I was just like, how can they move that fast? But they do.
Yeah, they do. I've seen them move pretty quick. And then other times, like, you shoot them and the arrow goes through and they just kind of look around. And you just walk off and I shot it and it just kind of turned around and stood out in the field about 30 yards away. It was standing there kind of wobbling, and so I was like, okay, it's 30 yards. I stuck another arrow in it.
Then it ran off
and we had trouble finding it, but we found it.
Yep. Well, that's how it was when I shot my elk last year. I shot that elk at, it was about 20 or 22 yards, and my arrow hit him and he didn't even move. He kind of set his feet like he was getting ready to run. And I was like, that was a really good arrow. So I was just going to put another one on and aim at the same spot. About the time I started to pull back on my bow, he finally, ran down the hill 60 yards and tipped over. But yeah, he didn't even flinch hardly. he didn't know what happened. But anyways, yeah, so it's a lot of fun, but anything can happen when you're hunting. So.
Yeah. Anywhere from them just standing there and not doing anything and falling over to walking away to running and run for miles. And
or they stand there and you missed and they just look at you. That happens.
Yeah. I haven't had that yet. When I've shot, they've always run off. I haven't had them stand there and look at me yet. But
yeah, I have a couple times. It's just been like, man, I don't know what I did there. But when I was younger, I haven't done that for a while, thank goodness. But yeah, it's fun.
I had one that was walk along this ridge and I shot, and I don't know what I did, but I missed and it hit a tree. I heard it thwack that tree. And deer kind of run a little bit. It was heading to my left. It head left and turned towards me and back around. And now it's standing broadside to me the other way, closer, looking at where that sound was. I was able to draw another arrow and I was able to get it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because the sound was on the other side. It ran away from the sound toward me.
Yep. You never know. You just be ready. Don't give up too quick.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and it's kind of nice when you have that same spot walking down a trail, shot at that one, and it went run off to my right, and then over to my left coming the other direction. I heard another deer coming while I was at full draw, waiting to shoot this one. And so I shot the one and it ran off, and I turned around where I heard the sound coming from about 20 yards away, or near the other trail is on. I load up another arrow and I drew back and waited to come to opening and shot. So I shot two deer within a matter of 2-3 minutes.
Yeah. It's, I don't know. Sometimes it just happens like magic, and other times you can't make it happen no matter what.
Yeah. The worst one is when they come by and you shoot at one and you miss it. And you got like three arrows with you. No one comes by, you shoot at, you miss it. And then next thing you know, you're out of arrows and they still keep coming by. They're like, I can't shoot you. I don't have any arrows, and I can't get down and go grab one of mine. For one, they're dull. And two, I don't want to spook them out of the area for the next time I come there and shoot better this next time.
Oh yeah. Yeah. That's archery hunting, man. That's why we do it all the time. Cause you got to go back out and see what happens next, you know?
Yeah. Always something different in the field. You never know. And
yeah. Yep.
Well, we've been on about an hour and a half now. So
yeah, I'm looking at the clock thinking, I got to open the shop here in about 30 minutes.
Oh yeah. We better let you go.
Yeah. I got to get going here in a minute. So
yeah, anyways. It's been real great talking to you. Very interesting stories. I know I enjoyed them. I'm sure our listeners enjoyed them. It's just been so nice having you on the show. Yeah, you have any parting thoughts before we head out?
I don't know. Good luck, man. Just practice and hunt hard.
If you're not shooting any better, go to a coach and learn how to shoot better. Yeah. Listen to them.
Definitely, it's worth it to spend a little bit of time with somebody who can help you out if you're having any trouble. I mean, go to your archer shop, make sure your bow's tuned right. Those things make a really big difference at the end of the day when you're hunting. So your success will go up for sure. Making sure your equipment is right and that you're ready to make a good shot. And you should be able to find, somebody close by that can help you out with that and get it figured out. So,
yeah. It's not as much about the name brand as does it fit you.
Yes, exactly. So, make sure you're comfortable and you're having fun, and your success will go up for sure. So, yep.
So, but like, anyways, thank you for, yeah.
Yep. Go ahead. Thanks for having me on. It's been fun talking. So,
yeah, that's the thing. You get a couple archers together, we can talk for hours.
Yeah, right. You just never end. You can talk forever. Hunters are. Yeah, that's a problem when they get together and start talking every time and you can't stop. So,
yeah.
Yep. Anyways. All right. Well, it was good. Good meeting you, and maybe we'll see you again someday.
Yeah. Yeah. My name is Rory Canterbury, host today on Arch Talk 101, and stay tuned for the next one. We have more exciting podcasts coming up, so don't miss them.